Hi to everyone, and thanks for watching this video. The title of my talk is Single Domain Free Logic and the Problem of Compositionality. The main aim of this talk will be to present a new semantics for non-referring terms and sentences that contain these terms. The general structure of this talk is the following. So at first, I will briefly outline the standard semantics for non-referring terms. And then I will point out three problems for these standard accounts based on free logic. And after that, I will justify and present an alternative that could solve at least the free problems that I've pointed out. And then in the end, I will outline two possible extensions of this account to modal logic. So this is so to speak the start of a project, and this is the simple extensional basis for it. And my idea in future is then to develop it also for more intentional and hyper intentional languages. The content of this talk is also partially identical with a paper that I published this year online with the same title, but this paper contains much more other arguments and lays out the account in much more detail, and also extends it in more detail to S5 type modal logic. But on the other hand, there are also some new arguments and new problems that I will only present in this talk, and that are not contained in the paper and not yet contained in any paper so far. The standard framework to account for the semantics of non-referring terms and the semantics of sentences that contain these terms is a single domain free logic that is based on a specific single domain semantics. And our first question that we want to address is, what is a single domain semantics for free logic? Let me briefly give an overview over this. So at first, it's a model theoretic semantics, and for this purpose we will at first lay out the main components. The first component of such a model theoretic semantics is a model, a free model. Our first free model is FM1. It has the following three constituents. So the first constituent is a domain of discourse. A domain of discourse contains objects that play the role of a reference for variables and individual constants. And we have two different options to conceive of this domain of discourse, either in a classical way, that is, we allow every kind of set of objects as a possible domain of discourse, with the exception that we exclude the empty set. If we also include the empty set, we get a so-called inclusive semantics. This is are the first two options with respect to this semantics. The second component is a domain relative interpretation function. This interpretation function in our framework assigns only extensions to predicates, n place predicates, and it's basically like in classical predicate logic. Our third component is now a specific denotation function that interprets individual constants only, and that is also used to model the denotation of variables, but the interpretation of the variables is proposed by another function, and we'll come to this in a minute. So the denotation function assigns objects from the domain of discourse to our individual constants, but it is partial. So this is the main difference between classical semantics and this kind of semantics. So that means that some individual constants may lack a denotation. The these are the three components or parts of our model. Apart from this model, we make use of two more semantic functions. The first one is an assignment function. This assignment function assigns objects from the domain D to our individual variables. In case of option one, it's basically like in classical predicate logic. But if we also have an exclusive interpretation of our domain, then there is this possibility that the assignment of a var of variables is in that sense partial, that no objects can and are assigned to our variables. But apart from this exception, always each variable gets a value assigned. And the last component of our semantics is now evaluation function. That evaluation function is domain and assignment relative. And we have in this respect three options. So this evaluation evaluation function assigns truth values to our sentences, and it can do it in a classical two-valued way, so that it assigns a more or less classical way that it assigns the value true or false to our sentences. But there are other options possible. So the first alternative option two, is we make use of a free-valued valuation function that assigns, apart from the two classical truth values, also the value n, which stands for neither true nor false. Or a third option is that our valuation function is partial, so not only our denotation function is partial, such that it assigns only classical values, but to some formulas it doesn't assign any value. So this is are the basics of this semantic basic components. Now in the next section, I will briefly outline the truth conditions. And for our purpose and the problems that I want to discuss, it's only necessary to outline the truth value conditions for simple sentences. And I use the label simple sentences to cover non-logical atomic sentences and logical atomic sentences. So the ordinary atomic sentences we can give them, that's one option, a two-valued semantics. On the basis of these two-valued semantics, we have relatively classical truth conditions. That is, we have there's one exception. So we have to guarantee for the truth of a formula that the denotation function assigns values to all use individual constants. But so this, so to speak, this is some sort of addition we have to make because our denotation function is partial. In the classical setup, this is already presupposed and cannot be. It is always the case. Yeah. And if this precondition is now in this case guaranteed, we then have the classical truth conditions. And now the first change is with the falsity condition. On this basis, there seem to be two possibilities why such a formula can be false. One is that this fails in some sense, that at least one term does not refer, or this condition fails if this is satisfied, because the classical fault condition is that these n-tuples are not an element of the interpretation of our predicate. So these are the two valid semantics, but one could also give, and some people think this is the more adequate one, so there's a dispute about which of these two semantics is the more adequate one. So we had can also give a free value or a partial semantics. On the free valued semantics, we say that the truth and falsity conditions of classical logic are basically correct. And in our setup to get these classical truth and falsity conditions, we have to add this kind of precondition. But because we have this precondition, we have now a third option, namely that this precondition is not satisfied. And now this kind of semantic reserve the third value for this failure with respect to this classical precondition. Or they say if the denotation function is undefined, this transfers also to the level of a sentence, and therefore the sentence is also undefined. So this might be two different options. One that says that the undefinedness is transferred, and the other says that the undefined has as a result a specific truth value. So far to the ordinary atomic sentences, and typically versions of negative free logic make use of this kind of semantics, and version of neutral logic of either of these two alternative semantics. Now let us come to singular existential sentences. So the idea is our existence predicate is in this frameworks a logical predicate, and therefore the truth conditions are also have also a special status. So the idea is it sufficient for such a sentence that it becomes true that the term that it contains refers to something, and therefore this denotation function is defined with respect to this term. And then the only other option for a condition on this basis is that the denotation function with respect to the term is undefined. But then there's an option between three choices. Also, one could say that the undefined leads to the falsity of the sentences, to the fact that it's neither true nor false, or also, like in this case, that it becomes undefined. So the idea is one idea. The basic idea of partial semantics is if there's an undefined somewhere on the expression level, there must also be an undefinedness on all other levels, and also on the top level then, which is the sentence level. So far for the brief review of the singular existential sentence and their semantics on this basis, or the possible semantics on this basis, then the only remaining thing in the standard frameworks are now identity sentences. So identity sentences are treated very different, very similar than any other ordinary two-place predicates, but with one exception. The idea is identity is also a logical relation. There are specific arguments that are valid because of the meaning of this expression, and therefore we fix the meaning of the identity relation such that it means always the same and is a logical constant in this sense. And this is the only difference. Apart from this, the conditions are structurally similar to the corresponding atomic sentences, and also the choice is the same. So we have the same strategy here with respect to identity sentences based on a free valued or partial semantics. And the only exception here is that we fix the meaning of the identity sign. So this is nothing interestingly new. So this is all we needed for our purposes. Certainly there are truth conditions for connective sentences and quantified sentences, but this is not really relevant for our topic here, and for the problems I want to outline. We will come to the issue of quantification, nevertheless, a bit later, because there is some relation between quantification and existence. So, the second section is concerned with three main problems of this these accounts, and I think not only from a linguistic perspective, but also from a philosophical perspective, these accounts are in a certain respect problematic. So the first thing is there is a general compositionality problem that I would like to present that concerns all so far presented simple sentences. And then I will, although there are other problems, I will only discuss in this talk two more compositionality problems that concern existential sentences and their negations. So the first thing is, what is this problem of compositionality with respect to all these sentences? So in two and three valued single domain semantics, we provide a compositional semantics of simple sentences with only referring singular term. Also with respect to these expressions that are like in classical logic, we provide like in classical logic compositional truth conditions. So that means we have semantic values for each expression that a sentence contains, and on the basis of these extensions, we calculate the truth value or extension of a sentences. But that the thing is different, and if a non-referring term is contained into a sentence. So simple sentences that contain at least one non-referring term have, according to these semantics, non-compositional truth conditions. And we will, I will, de also I will sh explain in a minute a bit clearer what this in fact means. Yeah. But it is clear that not, also not every expression has a certain semantic value, and therefore not the values only of some expressions play a role in determining the truth value, and it's not even clear whether they really play this role. So it seems more that in these non-compositional frameworks, that the truth values are more or less stipulated, and to some extent, or in some frameworks, they even seem to be relatively unprincipled. There are differences. I will come to them briefly. But especially our two and three valued semantics seem to be really unprincipled. So this is an additional problem for them. But in any case, they seem to be stipulated in all cases and not compositional in this sense. And from first, one could say from a linguistic point of view, it is clear that a proper form of semantics for any kind of sentences of something which might call a language. And which assigns truth values with respect to all meaningful and non-defective sentences has to be compositional. And we can also say from a philosophical point of view that such a compositional semantics is also preferable because it is more uniform and more simple. Because in this case we have here a different treatment for sentence with referring to singular terms then with respect to non-referring terms. This seems to also to be a strange asymmetry. And it is desirable, if possible, to have a more symmetric and uniform treatment of the semantics. An interesting exception now is partial semantics. So partial semantics seems to be aware of this problem and bites the bullet and says everywhere where there is no compositionality or we cannot provide a compositional calculation of a truth value, we should not assign any truth value. So in all these cases, the undefined is transferred from a lower level to the highest level. But this has a big price, because on this basis we get a very, very weak logic, because this then not only has to concern our atomic sentences, but also our quantified sentences and especially our connective sentences. And then we get a very weak logic, the so-called weak Kleene logic. So let me so it would be at least desirable if they really are interesting alternatives, they should be also more principled, and it would be good if they could be compositional and therefore be a really good competitor to partial semantics. And I will then afterwards show how such a semantics can be provided as a serious competitor of partial single domain semantics. But before that, let me just briefly present the problem a bit more precisely on the basis of a Phrygian semantic interpretation of atomic sentences. So for Frege, we use the most simple example, monadic simple sentences. We have for each term its specific extension of val semantic value. So the values of individual constants are entities, and the values of predicates are functions from entities into truth values. And the idea is, if we now plug in here into this function a specific referent of A, then the result is a specific truth value, because this function map each object that is an applicant of this to which this predicate applies, yeah, the truth value true, and to all other things the truth value false. And the extension of a sentence is a truth value, and we can easily calculate this on this basis, which is really was one of the most important inventions with respect to semantics from Frege, and this is still heavily used in the linguistic literature. So, and then the problem arises, if I have at least one term that does not contribute anything, no extension at all, yeah, and it's also not clear how we could extend our pro so give a compositional Phrygian semantics, because Phrygian and Taskian semantics are quite similar with respect to the idea. So they have a different story about compositionality, as we have seen, but they provide they aim to provide a compositional semantics, and then an extension to expressions where we cannot do justice to this idea seems to be a problem, yeah? And we have now this problem: we cannot calculate anymore the truth value. And so I think on the basis of a Phrygian version of our logic or of our semantics, it's even more obvious, this problem. So the second problem now concerns only singular existential sentences. So there is a they have this general problem certainly also, but they have an additional problem, and that concerns basically this special kind of truth conditions and falsity conditions. As we can see, at first sight, one sees already that this condition only concerns the semantic value of T. It says either the value is there, yeah, or it says it's not there. And ordinary, this is only a precondition for truth, yeah. And this might be at least also, this might be a sufficient condition for a third value, but or for an undefinedness. The best thing we can get on this basis is here that the undefinedness is seems to be some sort of a plausible option. But the general problem is now the following, or with respect to this very peculiar truth conditions. Neither in the case of a referring or a non-referring version of T in this kind of sentence does the semantic value of this existence predicate play any role concerning the determination of the truth value of a sentence of this form. According to standard two and three valued single domain semantics. Yeah? So the thing is a bit different in the partial semantics, but on the other side, it doesn't make sense at all. Yeah? That this expression does not play a role at all. But even on the basis of a partial semantic, one could say, okay, this expression is undefined, but does this mean Nevertheless, that the other expression should have a semantic value, and that should at least be relevant. Even though here nothing is provided. And then the term, the existence predicate, is in such a framework also considered as meaningful, and it should have therefore a semantic value. But weirdly, these truth conditions do not assign any semantic value to these sentences, and therefore, these sentences, for other reasons, do not have compositional truth conditions. So it should play some role with respect to determination of a truth value if we have a compositional truth condition, but it doesn't. And so this is another kind of additional weakness with respect to this idea. And in Frege terms, one can spell it out in this way. So the idea is, if I have an expression, let's think of the good case where t refers to, then the question should be why, what makes this sentence true? Then the Fregean would say, yeah, we need a specific kind of function that maps entities to truth values. And probably in the case of existence, one option would be then to say that every entity is mapped to the true, yeah, and this is then why this value gets the truth. But in our semantics, such kind of function plays no role at all, or is not even mentioned. But then the problem gets more severe if one sees looks to a case where we have no value on both sides, yeah, and even and in this. And also not clear which kind of function could here play a role because we have no value here. So the second and the third problem meet here in a very bad way. So it seems to be unclear how we could change here the value of this expression to get really some kind of truth value. So the best thing we could do is to give a partial semantics. But this is also from an intuitive point of view not really desired because intuitively we want to have some negative existential sentences that are true. And if they are undefined, then there is no good reason to say that the negations are true. Then they should also be undefined. So this is then the problem that we cannot on this basis provide even plausible truth conditions. So neither compositional nor plausible. That was the second problem. Now let us turn to the third problem. So the third problem now concerns negations of singular existential sentences and specific compositional difference between different kinds of negations and their truth values. So the idea is from an intuitive point of view, it seems to be possible to distinguish two or even three different kinds of negations. So one could argue that the first kind of negation is just some sort of denial that a predicate applies to an object. So if I say Sandy Island does not exist, in an unstressed and literal sense, I mean that existence is not a property of Sandy Island. And this is also reflected in the classical falsity conditions of atomic sentences, where we have such kind of condition. And if we take it seriously, that this kind of negation is so to speak, a copula negation, then we negate the relation between an object or a semantic value of the expression Sandy Island and the extension of the existence predicate. And we say that this object is not element of the extension. So this is the first kind of negation. The second kind of negation operates on the predicate itself, and we cannot do this on the basis of the verb exists, but it seems to be that Sandy Island exists and Sandy Island is existent are only syntactically different variation, but on the basis of these syntactically different variations, we nevertheless get a new option with respect to negation. Nämlich, we have this prefix non, and this prefix seems to modify the predicate. So the idea is then, in this case, we predicate a negative property, and we do not deny that a property is part. So we transform here the extension. And one idea is that we use some sign or this is some side of complement operation that we have the extension of existent, and this operation maps the extension of this whole sentence to the complement of this. Yeah. And then the question is now whether our singular of semantic value of this expression Sandy Island is an element of the complement of the existence predicate. This is our second kind of negation. And then the most philosophically familiar and logically familiar kind is a more sentential kind of negation. So in this case, no specific expression or no specific act is negated, or the predication is not negated, but the whole sentence is to declared as not being true, or a whole state affairs declared to be not the case. So there seem to be different variations. So one could say it's not the case, it's not true. And there are different ways to analyze it. So one idea might be to say it's not even so different from this kind, because here we refer to a proposition, yeah? And here we negate, for example, that it's true that this proposition, or that the state of affair to which this expression refer is not the case. Yeah? So that might be one philosophical option. But to simplify the things here, I will treat it standardly as a sentential negation. But on the sentential side of negation, we have now a different option for the truth condition, because it doesn't then really matter what the semantic values of this expression are. So we are only interested in the result at the end. So we are interested in the truth value of this expression, and then this sentential negation maps it to some other value, yeah? Some opposite value. And in the classical setting, it's from true to false, or from false to true. That might be then a bit different in a free-valued setting. But here we see it's an operation on a whole sentence and its extension, and therefore this is different. Yeah? But now there come there are now two problems that appear on the basis of the outlined truth conditions of negated sentence. So the first thing is that literal and unstressed uses of sentence like 1, 2, 3 seem to be intuitively equivalent in truth value, and it doesn't matter whether these sentences contain referring or non-referring names. So if Sandy Island refers to a real island, then Sandy Island does not exist is false. But Sandy Island is non-existent is also false, and the third sentence is also false. But let us assume that Sandy Island does not refer at all, or refers to a non-existent object. Then it seems to be that all three candidates have, in the same sense, the good option, or it seems to be plausible to assume that they are all true. Yeah? So intuitively, you would say they are all either true or false. It depends on the status of this kind of referential term. In this sense, they are true value equivalent. Yeah? And the other thing is that the compositional structure of this different kind of negation also seems to be different. At least, also, there are some people who would say there is no difference between 1 and 3. I still think there is one, and one could use it to force this sentential negation if one stresses the not. So Sandy Island does not exist. It seems to be that what one wants to say is the same as this sentence. But this seems to be a pragmatic phenomenon. So the literal and unstressed use, I think, is different. And then we have really a problem. So our single domain free semantics has problems to account for the data, and for the compositional differences between these three kinds of constructions. And why? So, because the true and the falsity conditions are very simple. So the only kind of negation we get seems to a negation with respect to the undefinedness. Yeah. So we have our truth condition is that it is defined. So the only w so whether we say it's undefined or it's not def the case that it's defined doesn't make any difference. Yeah. So we seem to have on these levels not really the option to distinguish, especially these two kinds. And the matters become even different. It seems to be the case that on this level it makes an important difference if this is really the compositional structure of these sentences, then we require a semantic value to get a truth value at all in this case 1 and 2, because such a sentence is only then true if A is not an element of this, or if A is an element of the complement. So if Sandy Island does not refer, these two sentences should not get a value at all. Yeah. And so these are the two things that our semantics cannot explain. So it cannot explain if this term does not refer, how this can be true. These two, if Sandy Island does not refer, it can only explain why three is true on this basis, but it cannot explain why these sentences are true. There must be some true or either false or neither true nor false on this basis of this condition. So, and they cannot make these structural differences. So I think these are two different aspects of the problem and our third problem. So now I want at first to explain the details of a solution. So the main idea for the solution of these three problems and a new perspective on the semantics for non-referring terms. So my main idea is the following. We distinguish between a semantic value or a compositional value of a singular term and its semantic referent. Yeah? And the semantic referent of a referring term is, as usual, a single object, and a non-referring singular term clearly does not have a semantic referent. But now the idea is semantic values are some more higher order object that are needed for semantic composition in these tricky cases. And one easy, but only one example is to say that the semantic value of a referring singular term is now a singleton that contains the semantic referent, and the semantic value of a non-referring term is the empty set. But there could be other ways and other alternative. As we will later see, we could also use some sort of functions also to make this difference. But this is a nice thing to have on each level and for each sentence a value that could be used to calculate the truth value. Yeah. And then the idea is now that the notation function does not assign anymore to singular terms reference, but semantic values. So, and if we make this kind of distinction and this kind of changes with respect to the denotation function, we certainly have to adjust our truth conditions in a way that fits to these changes. But before we do so, I will try to give two arguments in favor of this move. Why it seems to be on the first side a bit ad hoc or tailor-made, and now I will try to show why it is more principled than it might appear on the first sight. So one problem is that we do not only have so these outline problems of compositionality, but we also have problems concerning meaningfulness. So the idea is in a semantic framework that uses denotation and interpretation functions as tool to assign meanings or semantic value to non-logical expression, an expression to which such a function assigns no value is literally meaningless. So it seems to be that these two-valued and free-valued semantics seem to be a misconstruction at all. So only this partial semantics seems to take this point seriously and is happy to claim that some expressions are meaningless. Yeah? But sentences that contain meaningless expressions are themselves meaningless and cannot receive a truth value as semantic value. Yeah? And as I've already said, partial semantics seems so the only way to deal with such sentences from a principled and semantic point of view. And one could also say that partial semantics is a theoretical option, but from a philosophical and linguistic side, different to motivate, especially in the case of non-referring descriptions and non-referring names. One has the feeling that these expressions are meaningful, and therefore a partial semantics doesn't seem to be the right choice. Yeah? And our distinction now, so one of the good, so the first good thing about our distinction is that it could explain or could account for the meaningfulness of our terms. Yeah? So even non-referring terms have a meaning. Have an assigned meaning, and hence also there is at least so for a basis why these sentences could receive a truth value and a truth value apt, yeah. And that would is then really so some progress with respect to these alternatives to partial semantics, which then could also lead to stronger logics than partial semantics. But now this is only so some sort of additional argument one could say to our compositionality problems. But now the real main argument is the following for our semantic lift or abstraction. So the idea is the following. We can start our thinking about semantics with a very by making use of two very basic semantic relation, and we can on this basis give a so-called alchemist semantics for monadic atomic sentences, which goes as follows. So the idea is that what accounts for the meaningfulness of a singular term is the reference relation, the semantic reference relation. What accounts for the meaningfulness of a predicate is the relation of semantic application. And so one could define truth conditions for atomic sentences on this basis very easily. FA is true if A refers to an object and FA applies to this object. And FA is false if and only if A refers to an object and F does not apply to this object. And these conditions seem to provide intuitively plausible truth and falsity conditions, at least with respect to the assignment of classical truth values to atomic sentences. So it seems to be intuitively plausible that on the basis of these conditions we could say that a sentence is true, and on the basis of these conditions that a sentence is false. Yeah. But clearly on this basis we have now also excluded non-referring names, but we could also include them by some sort of compositional trick. So we now make use of a different kind of negation. Here we have a narrow scope negation. Now we make use of a wide scope negation. Then we can treat a reference failure very similar as an application failure. And then there are two different ways why such a sentence can be false, either on the basis of a reference failure or on the basis of an application failure. Yeah. But the problem with all these conditions is now that they are not compositional in the modern sense of the term. So we have now a compositionality problem on both sides. Yeah? Namely, if we have no referent and if we have no applicant, then we have no semantic value that could play a role with respect to determining a truth value. Yeah? So, and especially, so this is then especially obvious. If we have predicates that do not apply to any object, so on this semantics, non-referring terms and non-applying predicates are very similar. Yeah? And then the interesting thing is that Taskian and Phrygian semantics seem to make here a difference, and both kind of semantics do not make use of this kind of truth condition. They make use of other truth conditions, and I think they have a good reason to do so. Because they want to provide a compositional semantics for these sentences, but their concern is only with respect to these kind of sentences that contain singular terms that refer to something. And we have no problem to provide a semantic value if we stipulate that such a term always refers to something. Then we have at least a value with this respect, and that's the way both Taskens and Fregeans do it. But the problem then arises if we have these application conditions, we would have to exclude false sentences, because if there is no application there, we do not have a value here. And even on the basis, if we have this good case, it doesn't matter. It doesn't make sense to say that the semantic value of a predicate is a single object to which it applies. Yeah. Even on this basis, one does not get a good calculation of the truth value of such a sentence. So I think this is then the main reason why Taskent and Fregean semantics make use of some other kind of truth conditions. And let me now show what they do to solve this problem that Occamist semantic has. So they make a one-sided abstraction with respect to the semantic value. So what they do is that they make use of an abstracted value of a new value for predicates that is abstracted from the intuitive semantic value, namely the applicants of a predicate, and they use it as semantic values for predicates to be able to give a compositional semantics and compositional truth conditions for atomic sentences, but with referring singular terms only. So for the terms, they do not need such kind of abstraction, but for the predicates, if they make use of this idea of compositional semantics, they have to make this abstraction. And we know that these two abstractions are different, but in some sense equivalent. So the ones so the Taskens abstract from the applicants to sets of applicants, and therefore have in these sets values. And even if the predicate does not apply, the empty set is still a value. Yeah, and we can calculate on this basis a truth value. Yeah. And the second thing is that Fregean semantics has functions from objects into truth values that pair the applicants of a predicate with the true and all other objects with the false. And we have now also an abstracted value that can play a role to calculate the truth value of the whole sentence on the basis of the given values. So far, so good. So if one moves from Occamist semantics to a Taskent semantics or a Fregean semantics, which are both compositional, one has to make only one kind of adjustment. But now the idea is, if I also want to include non-referring names, it seems to be that I'm allowed to do the same thing on the other side. So the my additional crucial premise of my main argument is now the following. If Taskens and Fregeans use abstracted semantic values as semantic values of predicate to be able to account for compositional truth conditions for simple sentences that only contain referring names, then it should be allowed for equal reasons to make use of a very similar kind of abstracted semantic values for names to account for compositional truth conditions for simple sentences with referring and non-referring names. And so, if we see this relation, we then have these three types of semantic. On the left hand, we have Occamist semantics. In the middle, we have Taskent and Fregean semantics. On the other side, the new proposed semantics. And they are steps into the direction of a full compositional semantic for different kind of languages. Yeah. So the idea is, if my description of the Taskent and Fregean project is correct, and I think it's quite obvious that it is, then our step also seems to be justified on this basis. Another argument we could still give is, even if one doesn't accept this kind of story that I've given now, what what could justify this move. We could also say, let us see how the semantics look like and whether they do what they pretend to do. So because if they if or purport to do, because if they can really provide this compositional semantics for all kind of sentences, it seems to be also a good argument in favor of them, this kind of explanatory advantage. So in fact, the changes in a Taskian setting are similar, are quite simple. Also in a Phrygian setting, we would have now semantic values, not in any more objects, but sets that contain these objects, and then we have a function that maps these objects to truth values. And for example, in the case of an existence predicate, it would map all singletons to the true, and all the empty set to the false. But on the basis of a Taskian semantic that is standardly used for these kind of logics, we have to do to make these adjustments in a different way. So the idea is then we have now, instead of this guarantee of the definedness of our denotation functions, another condition, because we now have a total denotation function that assigns to every expression a value. But now the question is, what does this denotation contain? And therefore these conditions test whether there is some semantic referent there. And then if this is true, then we have the classical true condition that ask whether this referent or the this n-tuple of reference is an element of the extension of our predicate. So this is then the main adjustment, this kind of condition, and everything else is then the same as in the other cases. So and then we have also these two different choices for falsity, either if this condition is not satisfied or if this condition is satisfied but this condition is not satisfied. The same thing we can do with respect to our free valued semantics for atomic sentences, and then only the preconditions is now adjusted to our new framework. Yeah. And then it seems to be because we have always values on each levels, and these values play a role concerning the determination of a truth value. Then we could say it's a genuine compositional alternative, and this gives our two-valued and three-valued semantics a good chance to be a genuine and strong competitor for partial semantics. Yeah. With identity sentence, the story is not really interesting or particularly different. So I just present it here without much ado. So one could say here again we have this kind of making use of this logical relation in the meta language, and this is our standard condition that we now make use of to guarantee that we have a referent contained in our value, semantic value. Okay. But now I think the more interesting stuff, and this is the remaining part of this paper, will be concerned with existential sentences. So far we have seen our first problems could be solved on this basis, but we have not seen a solution to our second and third problem, and we will approach this now in on the following slides. So the first thing we will do is to provide a standard first order semantic for existential sentences on the basis of these outlined new conditions. So we could then also provide now compositional truth conditions for existential sentences. We have this part is our familiar conditions that checks whether some semantic value contains a semantic referent, and this condition provides the meaning for this term. And then the contribution of the existence predicate is that it has the same, always by stipulation, the same extension as our domain. And then the truth condition is that if there is a semantic value and this is part of our domain, then such a sentence is true. And the falsity condition is then the negation of this condition if it's not the case that these conditions are satisfied. But on this basis, we see we could at least solve our second problem, but not the third problem, because we have here now use for the falsity condition, the wide scope negation. And if we really have it's now a non-referring term here in this case, and make use of a narrow scope negation to account for the falsity, we would not get a condition that is really satisfied. So, because this condition cannot be satisfied without this condition. Huh? So we only seem to here have one option. And therefore, on this basis, we cannot make this kind of distinctions we have seen. The interesting thing is, on the basis of a semantics that does not make use of non-referring terms, but says that some terms refer to existent objects and other to non-existent objects, can provide a solution to our negation problem, and a very easy one, because for them the second and the first kind of negation do not seem a problem, and they could also give here a more narrow scope analysis for the falsity condition. But in our case, this is not problem. It's a problem that cannot be done. So the question is now whether we can give on the basis of our sense as a framework and alternative semantics that can do this job and solve also the third problem. And the interesting thing is, on the basis of our treatment of singular terms, we in fact can distinguish two different kinds of predicates. So we can say a first order predicate is a predicate with respect to the semantic referent, and we could also have a very special and restricted sort of second order predicates, which are predicates of our semantic values. So we have some, in this sense, a bifurcated nature of the contribution to the truth conditions of such a term. This is a bit similar like the Frege from the Begriffsschrift, who says also that the meaning of such terms is different in the case of identity sentence and other sentences. And our move is now similar, but it concerns not now identity sentences, but existential sentences. And on this basis, we can give a different kind of semantics of existential sentences. So the first thing is now, for this purpose, we have to define a new abstracted kind of domain. So this is called our domain. Exclamation mark, and it's the set of all subsets of D that contain exactly one element. And if we can abstract this from the ordinary domain, that's a quite easy abstraction in purely logical and set theoretic terms. And the interesting thing is, now on this basis we can now define a second order existence predicate. And the idea is, now we marked also in a syntactic in a clear way this second order sentence, second order predicates with a star, and these second order predicates are predicates of the semantic values. And then we have these truth conditions because the idea is then if the semantic value of the term T is contained into this defined abstracted domain, then an existential sentence should be true. And these conditions are logically equivalent. So it seems to be another kind of presentation of the same thing. Yeah? It's just on a different level. But now the interesting thing is that that one advantage of this kind of equivalent representation is that we could give here on this basis relatively classical falsity conditions, because we just have to say that the notation, the empty set, is not contained into this abstracted domain, and then we get the desired result. Yeah? And this has now two advantages. So on the one hand, as we will see in a minute, we can solve our negation problems on this basis, because we have then here different options to get to different conditions. And on the other hand, we can give some sort of account of the very peculiar nature of the existence predicate. We can say, yeah, in this sense, also from the linguistic data, it doesn't seem to be right that if a sentence like Sandy Island does not exist, a sentence like Sandy Island exists should be neither true nor false or undefined. It seems to be intuitive that such a sentence is plainly false. And why? And we can now explain why this is the best option, because if existence really is a second order predicate or a special kind of predicate and has this more classical type of truth and falsity conditions, that seems to be the more natural way. And so to speak, this explanation, also this kind of truth condition, tries to do justice to this peculiar nature of the existence predicate. And now very briefly an outline of the solution to our third problem. So the idea is now, and we have these truth conditions, and then with some simple further adjustment, we could also solve this problem with respect to the equivalence between different kinds of negation. So the first thing we have to do is we also need another kind of domain, the domain D star, which is now the domain of all second order predicates of this specific style that concern semantic values. And this is then the set of all subsets of the domain of the domain D that contain at most one element. So on this basis we have really all possible semantic values, and not only the values of referring terms. And then we can say, on the basis of our standards framework, where we have only a sentential kind of negation, we could also do the trick. So we do not have to introduce a new kind of negation operator that operates on predicates. We could also do it on the basis of some kind of scope distinction with respect to names, as it is used by Evans and Sainsbury. So we have the names with a wider and a lower scope, and a negation with this lower scope with respect to this name has done these kind of truth conditions. So then in the narrow case, the question is whether there is an object or there is something, and it's not the case that this predicate applies to it. And so we have a copula negation. So this is the special syntax for this, and these are the truth conditions. So we could say for the copula negation, we have now our falsity condition as truth condition for the negation. But for our predicate negation, we have now different kind of compositional conditions, because we now make use of some kind of complement operator, and then we could, if we want to do it in detail, we would have to really give a semantics for this kind of compositional semantics for this kind of operator. Here, just for simplicity, we here show what it does. Now in our case, we have this domain star of all possible values that such a predicate, a second order predicate might contain, and then we subtract from this domain the extension of our second order existence predicate, and then we exactly have the complement. Yeah? And then the question is whether the value of our the semantic value of our name is element of this complement. Yeah? And this is some sort of different compositional condition, and we also now have, because we have this narrow condition, and we can also now provide for our wide scope negation a different kind of condition, structurally different kind of condition, and then we could explain on this basis why there might be structurally different kind of negations, and nevertheless these three sentences a truth value equivalent, and therefore we have solved our third problem. So in the last two sections of this paper, I will very briefly outline and show how this kind of semantics could also be extended to a more intentional language, of which, for example, modal logic makes use. And the idea is just to focus on the semantics of existential sentences, to show on this basis how we could use our strategy to provide also compositional truth conditions for existential sentences on the basis of these frameworks that give us the desired results with respect to plausible truth conditions and to with respect to the solution of our three outline problems. So for the first kind of semantic framework we will make use is a very variable domain framework. So the idea is the following: we make use of the following structure that contains a set of worlds. D is a domain of reference now, and the second D is a function from worlds in the domain of quantification. So these domains may vary from word to word. And their main semantic use is to account for the domains for our quantifications and not for the reference of our terms, because our terms have a constant denotation, and only our interpretation function is relativized to possible worlds. So just briefly to explain how such a variable domain semantic works on the basis of our new framework is we have very standard truth condition for quantification, and here we have these relativized domains to provide our truth conditions, but the significant difference is now that we assign also to our variables singletons. But nevertheless, we only assign those which are part of our variable domains. So therefore, we have this restriction here, and the differences with respect to the assignments. Yeah? And then we can make use on this basis of our new truth conditions for atomic sentences, to provide truth conditions for such sentences that contain open sentences and lead to quantifications on this basis. So, but now the more interesting thing, or the thing that I'm more interested in, is how we can now extend our second order semantics for singular existential sentences also to this case. And then there's only two minor adjustments necessary. And firstly, we also have to get some sort of variable domain or a variable extensions for our existence predicate that might be different from word to word. And we get this on the basis of a new abstracted variable domain. This is now the set of all subsets of objects there are element of DW that contain exactly one element. And on this basis, we can now provide the following truth conditions. So, standardly, we now relativize our truth conditions to worlds. And then on the other side, the only world relativized parameter is now on the basis of this new interpretation of the varying extension of the existence predicate relative to different possible worlds. And then the question is whether our constant referent is part of this varying domain or not. And it is false if our referent is not part. And on this basis, we can account also for the standard idea of that I might exist in one world and not in the other. And nevertheless, we speak about the same object. And we could certainly then, with adjusted ordinary modal operators, also to account for truth conditions for sentence why I might not exist and so on, so forth. So this was the first brief extension of our semantics of the existence predicate. And now the last thing I want to do is to ask the question whether it's possible to have a logical existence predicate relative to a constant domain semantics for modal logic based on our new framework. And on the first side, it seems to be this is not possible if we do not change our semantic values, because we do not have something like a variable domain anymore that does the trick to provide different kind of world relative extension for existence predicate. So we have to find another way to get such a purely logical domain that varies and provides the right kind of extension for existence predicate. And the last thing I want to do is to very briefly sketch such a kind of semantics, which is at least from a semantic point of view a constant domain, because we have a constant set of objects over which we quantify. Although it then has also some typical properties of a variable domain framework, more in a logical sense. So it's an interesting mixture, I think. And the idea is the following. Now we have a structure that contains again worlds, and all things are the same, except that we now have, instead of our variable domains, a constant domain D star. And this constant domain D star is now in that sense different and also required additionally to our domain D, because our domain D contains individuals, while our domain D star contains so-called individual concepts as elements. Hence, we need both of them, and they have different kind of elements. And what are individual concepts? So individual concepts are now total functions from worlds to singletons or the empty set. And to make this new idea of an individual concept clear, and which is based on our new semantics, is the following way. So we can I will give you two examples. So if we look at the individual concept dwarf, it's so that this individual concept maps all and only worlds relative to which dwarf exists to the singleton that only contains dwarf, and it maps all other worlds to the empty set. And for example, the individual concept of God would, if God exists, certainly would map all and only worlds relative to which God exists to the singleton that contains God. And because God necessarily exists, there is no word that is mapped to the empty set. And so we have here an option to account for different kind of individual concepts. And there still is certainly also now an individual concept on this basis for Sandy Island, because Sandy Island is now an actually non-existent island, and it should be on this basis also an individual concept for no entity at all. So it maps all worlds to the empty set, and so we have basically three different kind of individual concepts. And we could also extend this idea to include also possible objects. So then the difference between an individual concept of an actually existing object should be then that the actual world is mapped to a singleton that contains this object. And in the case of possible object, the actual world would be mapped to the empty set. And on this basis, we then also get a new hierarchy of semantic values and reference. So we have our primary semantic value for individual constants. This is now our individual concept. And a secondary semantic value of an individual concept. This is now the set that contains the referent. So this is our ordinary semantic values on the basis of our extensional predicate logic. And then the third level is are then the reference, if our constant has a referent at all. And then the denotation function assigns primary semantic value to our individual constants, and we also quantify over individual constants. And we have certainly then to adjust on this basis all our truth conditions for atomic sentences and all other sentences. And certainly we then have the choice of different kind of predicates for all three levels. So this is then also an interesting feature. So we can now the final thing we will now do is to show how we can give a composition a second order intentional semantics for the existence predicate on this basis and have it as a and such that it comes out as a logical pre existence predicate. And the trick now is we define our domain now in a completely different way because we do not have these varying quantifier domains. We have to get this varying thing out of the individual concept. So the idea is now our last domain with two exclamation mark is again word relative, but it's the set of all values of all individual concepts relative to M, and so our model and a specific world that contain exactly one element. So only these are interesting for our purpose, and all the others are excluded. And then we can define on this basis of this kind of abstracted new domain, word relative domain, also an existence predicate for such a semantics with a constant domain of quantification. So we again relativize our sentences to truth values, but now we have a two-step process to calculate the values of these ex for terms. So the first thing is we have a denotation. This denotation is an individual concept, and then we have to get the value of this individual concept with respect to our world where we want to assign the truth value, and then we get as result some sort of set at a singleton or the empty set. And then the question is whether the singleton or empty set is part of this domain, of this specific domain, or it's not. So, and this gives us then equivalent truth conditions to the other one from a purely truth conditional, or they have the same truth values with respect to the same situations, but the composition they are different, but they again have all the required features to solve all our three problems. And I think the main interesting innovation is this new concept of individual concepts, and it's different, for example, from a similar strategy that is used in Preece 2005 and 2016, and also a similar but different kind of strategy that is used in Allony. in 2001 and 2005. So I think it would be an interesting subject of future research to compare these frameworks and to develop this framework in full detail and also apply it, for example, to the semantics of intentional transitive verbs and attitude description. Thanks a lot for your attention.